Mario Pellegrini's own story began on June 15, 1932, in New York City.
I grew up in New York City, in an Italian neighborhood that I was in. And we always had the story of somebody who comes to the city and gets off the train and puts his bag down and says, "Look at the big buildings." And then he looks down and his bags are gone. When I was 19, 20, I think, I joined the Air Force. And that got me out of New York, but it got me to some pretty exotic places I didn't want to be. I enlisted in 1950 and spent 5 years in the Air Force. And that was during the Korean War. And I learned a lot in the Air Force, and I saw what was happening in other countries. And I finally, when I finished my tour in the Air Force, the last base I was stationed at when I came back from overseas was Hill Air Force Base, Ogden, Utah. Going to college at Weber at night, courses up on the hill there, and a couple of low-lying buildings. We had our I majored in philosophy and anthropology and psychology. And that was really where my interests lie. I was in flight test in the Air Force and in special services. But there in Ogden, I read the Book of Mormon. I learned about the kind of people that were there. Very different people than in the rest of the places I've been, and great people. And that motivated me not only to get to understand that whole community, the whole value system that people live by out there in the Inner Mountain West. And when I took courses, I was lucky to have a great professor, Dr. Jennings Olson, who had 3 doctorate degrees. He graduated from the University of Utah, and then he went to Harvard, and then he went to Yale and got 3 degrees. And he was the head of the philosophy department. I was fortunate to get to Weber to find the kind of academic excitement that I was looking for, to find out about the values that we live by, what makes people who they are and what they believe in. And so Ogden and Weber was a place for me to make my dreams come true, the kind of person I wanted to be, the kind of world I wanted to live in. And that was just an inkling, just the beginning of what I learned at Weber.
Mario's professor, Dr. Jennings Olson, was invited to appear on the television show Great Issues in Religion and asked for his help.
Professor Olson was invited to appear as heading the philosophy department in a program on Sunday morning in Salt Lake City called Great Issues in Religion. And he was very busy marking papers and giving lectures and speeches and everything. And so he was assigned to come down on this Sunday. And I was a student of his at the time. And he said, "Listen, I haven't got time, but would you work up something, do some research, and write some things for me to say? The subject is the virgin birth." And I said, "Well, gee, you know, he said, just do some research and write some." So I went and checked out parthenogenesis, which is what virgin birth would be. And it did exist in some kind of small cell amoebas and that, where they had male and female genes, and it could become a generating new generation. But in mammals, higher mammals, no, there was no evidence biologically of virgin birth. And so I wrote all that, and then I thought, but gee, you know, I mean, every religion believes in Mary, Mother of God, you know. But if you, on faith, you can accept a virgin birth and believe in a virgin birth. And so that's what I wrote. Well, he went on the program on Sunday morning, and he read what I wrote. And it was, the switchboards lit up. Everybody in the Inner Mountain West was calling, "What is this? This is heresy." You know? And so he came out of there and he said, "Well, that's the last time they'll ever invite me on that program." It was not true. Very shortly after, the next week, they called and said, "Could you come back and they said, we want to talk to you about doing it on a permanent basis. You'll be the host. We'll have a rabbi, a priest, or a minister each week, and different subjects. And he said, I thought about it. I didn't want to do it because I was giving lectures and all. But I said, well, if I do it, I'll need a researcher, a writer, and a director. And he came to me, and I was a student trying to get a good grade. And he said, I've got a job for you. And I'll do the best job I can. And he said, you're the new researcher, writer, and director of Great Issues in Religion now. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. I said, I could do some research and writing, you know, and my philosophy is major. I said, but I've never directed anything. I don't know anything about it. He said, read up on it. We're on Sunday. And that was it. I went in and got some books about key light, but I knew nothing. And I went down there, and they said, he's from New York. You know, he's a New Yorker. So I went in bluffing my way. I said, yeah, well, in New York, I worked with them. And just before everything got by, I said, where's my tech? This is the guy that changed. You say the director says, camera one, go in tighter. Pan to camera two. And he's the guy that switches, the technical director. I said, but, you know, I knew that. Here's my tech, okay. And just before we go on the air, a guy walks up and he says, where do you want the Shamira light? And I didn't know what a light, Shamira light, I didn't have any idea in the world. And I said, well, let me ask you, you boys here in Salt Lake, where do you usually put it? And he says, well, we put it low so it takes the shadows out from underneath the eyes. I said, oh, okay, you're all right, you know what you're doing. And then I read like the devil about directing and so on. And Olson had a great lecture that he gave, which was on the Dead Sea Scrolls, the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1958, I believe it was. His presentation on Dead Sea Scrolls discovery, he went around all the schools and colleges and gave lectures, and they sold tickets to his presentations. And one winter, he got pneumonia. He had 106 fever. He was in bed. And he said, oh, this is so terrible. I've got to give back all the tickets. And that's going to be terrible. He said, well, there's nothing I can do because I can't get out of bed with this fever. The doctor said, I get it. So after that was over, I said, you know, when we're in that studio doing Great Issues in Religion, where everybody goes, I could put you on and you could do the presentation that you do from the podium. And then we could have the 10 questions that are most commonly asked. And we could have the whole thing. So we'll say, you're going to be there live or on the big screen. So you're not saying you're going to be there definitely live. And so we did the film on the Dead Sea Scrolls. And I got a boy there in Utah, and I put his little costume on like he was a Bedouin sheep herder. And there was plenty of sheep herders in Utah, as you know. And we got a garage, and we sprayed Halloween cobwebs and everything around and made it dark and found this big earthen jar. And we rediscovered the scrolls, and they went on and on. And that was the film that we had. And he never had to use it that I know of where he didn't appear after that. But the point is, the film got around. So he said, this is good. Because he was the great speaker. He was great. And then, of course, that went out. And somebody in L.A., saw it or something and said, who did this? Who's this guy? And I got an invitation to go down, and they said, are you in the Guild? I thought they meant as an actor or something. I said, no, we'll get you in. And they gave me Saul Bass, who's an Academy Award winner, and Jack Lemmon, and that's how I first met him, and somebody else, and I got in 1974. And I've been a member of the Directors Guild ever since. And the thing that I really came out of it, though, beyond this experience with Olson or with the is that what I learned about the Inner Mountain West and the people that were there gave me the foundation for the kind of films I wanted to make. I worked for other people, I made other films, but every chance I had at the beginning, I tried to work in the values that I believed about family and about respect for your elders. When I came to Utah, I was in Hill Air Force Base, and I met a beautiful girl there, and she was LDS, and I was in charge of the base library for a time. Although I worked in flight test, I had another responsibility because I was in special services. And she was something that I had never seen before. I mean, you know, the girls in New York, not like that. And then she was a wonderful person, a wonderful family. And we got married in Salt Lake City, in the park there by the City Hall. We had a daughter, and the thing that happened was that she, after we were married for 3 years, and she was a redhead. She was fair-skinned. And she started to like drop a frying pan or something, and she was, her blood was down, was weak. And she went into the hospital, and they said, well, we'll make some blood tests and everything like that. And then she went in the hospital again, and the doctor kept her in the hospital. And he didn't tell me. I went up there to visit and everything. He said, well, she's gonna have to stay another day. And then I couldn't get him at his office. The doctor finally was at the station, and I went down there to catch him. But 3 or 4 days, he wouldn't tell me. He didn't answer his calls or anything. And I caught him, and he said, I know. I wanna tell you, what we've done is a double blind test. We checked her blood in Texas, in Maryland, and in Washington. We don't tell them what it is. Everybody makes their own analysis. Whole classes of students make the analysis of her blood. And here are the reports. Leukemia, leukemia, leukemia. She has leukemia. And at that time, leukemia, there was no bone marrow transplant. There was no hope. She was 3 months to live, perhaps. And I said, oh, there must be something. And he said, no, if there was anything, we would have it here. I went up to the hospital on Easter Sunday. I got a call from a doctor. He said, I think you should come to your wife. And I went in, and she was there with all these tubes and everything. And she said, I want you to promise me that our daughter will be raised in the church. And I said, you're going to be okay. Don't worry. Don't worry. And she expired. The viewing, people came and went to the coffin. And then they had another private viewing in another dark room. And there was maybe 20 people in the room. And I went in, and nobody in Ogden knew me, really. I was always at Air Force Base or at home. And anyway, in the front row was a cowboy. He had his boots on and everything, and a young girl. And the young girl stood up and turned and said, going home, going home. I'm a going home. Mother's there, father too. I'm a going home. And then she started to cry. And the father stood up, put his arm around her. Going home, going home, I'm a going home. And that was the greatest experience of my wife passing, because the song says, it's not far, just away, through an open door, all my dreams, all my schemes, I'm a going home. And that has been with me all my life. That's something that I left in Utah, but it never left me.
The loss of his wife to cancer made Mario want to do something to fight cancer. In 1961, he went to the American Cancer Society and offered to help. He wrote, produced, and directed a television series entitled Frontiers in Cancer. He created 26 telecast programs, winning national awards. His program titled To Smoke or Not to Smoke was required viewing in 6th and 7th grade in schools across the nation.
And I wound up making a film down in Miami. And I found a beautiful girl, quite a bit younger than me, but beautiful as anything. She was a Cuban refugee. They had come from Cuba when Castro took over. And they saw people being shot in the streets and everything. She saw a real revolution. And luckily, her grandfather, who had been in the government, he was head of the Navy earlier in his career, he had contacts through the Catholic Church. They got them visas for her mother, her grandmother, and her, the three women. They got out of Cuba, came to Miami, because she said, my wife told me, we came to Miami because we knew there was still freedom here. And I realized that at the time, but I've realized it more and more and more. When she said, you know, this country is not going in the right direction. It's doing some things that are wrong. We've seen this before. Start getting government control of everything. And so it was a great experience. We had two sons, lived in Miami and moved to New York City and Washington, D.C. And I worked at the White House and directed a simulcast from Richard Nixon to George Bush Sr. And that included Gerald Ford after Nixon left office, and from Ford to Carter, from Carter to Reagan. And when it came to Reagan, I had worked with Reagan a long time earlier when he was a host of Death Valley Days, a TV show for Borax and Boraxo. And so we knew each other from the movie background, and his wife, Nancy, was an actress too. And so there was a really big opportunity, although I had been called there for Nixon, because when Nixon became president, he had a problem against John F. Kennedy, who was very telegenic, and Nixon was not telegenic. And so they said, we got to get somebody, some Hollywood director or somebody, to help him. So they called the Directors Guild in L.A., and they said, we need a guy to come in and help him on television appearances and everything. And can you get us a director? I said, yeah, but, and he's got to be a Republican. And they said, he's got to be a what? Are you kidding? And they said, a Republican? He said, yeah. They said, well, we have one guy who's a Republican. He even admits it. And so they said, and he's in Alexandria, Virginia right now. And I got a call and said, would you come to the White House? I went to the White House and they said, come in here. And I met him and they said, can you help him? And I said, woo, that's a pretty big order here, you know. But I said, well, sure, I'll try what I can do. And I did, but that wasn't his element. It was hard for him. But then I used Trish Nixon and Julie Nixon Eisenhower, who she's now Julie Nixon Eisenhower. And they would handle things, and Mrs. Nixon, things about the Boy Scouts rally or out on the lawn with the Easter eggs hunt and all, but keeping him for the political things that he had to say and everything like that. When Reagan came in, it was fantastic. And I had 8 years with Reagan, and he used me for all of his simulcasts, which were like, for him, fireside chats, when he talked to the whole country. He could override the Senate and the House and everything. He was very, very communicative.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the White House, the President of the United States.
Government alone cannot and should not do all things for all people. The business community can help, yet businesses must focus on their primary responsibility, producing America's goods and services. The voluntary sector, America's third force, works with both business and government to help those in need and organize community building programs. The goodwill among us underscores the values of free men and women. We Americans come from every corner of the world, of every race and religion, yet we care about one another. Perhaps even more than our great economic progress, more than our scientific achievements, more than our courage and strength, that is what we should be most proud of, the way we care.
He was a great president, as we all know now, but I was working with him and we had personal experiences. He was really just the greatest experience in my filmmaking in the political arena. I took many detours in the course of my film career, And one of them was when Pete Rozelle, who never played the game of football, invited me to his office. I said, well, you know, I think you cannot make a spot saying the NFL is the greatest league in sports history, you know. You're patting yourself on the back. What I would do is to sugarcoat the message. We could do a spot on the game with a player being the spokesman. I care about my community. I care about these children. And that's why I give to the United Way. So they raise money, and you're doing it for fundraising for the charities. And everybody has their pet charities. And United Way is the biggest conglomerate of that. So he said, what would we have to do? I said, well, you'd have to give me the time on the air, on the game. I mean, we can make them, they're not going to do any good unless. He said, okay, what else do you need? I said, well, I need a player to do a test so I can show you. I said, if you give us one spot, the United Way people will be happy as anything, you know. So he said, okay. 3 days later, he called me and he said, I got Reggie McKenzie from the Buffalo Bills. The player's coming down to the city of New York. And I said, okay, tell him to be there at 8 o'clock in the morning at this building and studio is there. And in walked Reggie McKenzie. And I put this together, and I honestly, in the editing room in New York, I said, this is the worst commercial I have ever put on film. And got a call from Rozelle's office. Did you get it? I said, yeah. Come up to the office tomorrow morning. I want to see it. I thought, that's the end of this. I'll never see this on an NFL game. And I went up, and he's already in the screening room waiting for you. Wow. And I go up, and the room's empty, except for him sitting in the front row like this. And I come in the back door, and I gave the guy the film. And I said, whenever you're ready, Commissioner. And the guy in the booth says, ready. Okay, the lights went down, and boom, on came. I'll be Reggie McKenzie of the Buffalo Bills, and I'm helping these people here, and so on. And I thought, oh, here it comes. He's going to get up and say, and kick me out of the room. He stood up when the lights went on. He turned around. And he said, could you do 32 of them? I said, what do you mean? He says, one for each team. And we would put it on at the two-minute warning before the half, because that's when most people are there. They're going to go get a beer and have a drink and everything at halftime or eat something. But we'll get them at the two-minute warning. And I said, yeah, that would be great. And then I said, but you know, it's to do 32 of them between now and the time the season starts. It's going to be a real stretch. And I said, it's going to cost a lot because I've got to travel to each one of the teams. And that's, you know, 30 cities. He said, yeah, well, what do you need? I said, well, I need the camera equipment. I need the men. He said, you know, we are going to be giving you for the United Way, for the charity, so many millions of dollars. Don't worry, you'll get everything you need. And then the United Way, I went to them and I said, we're going to get 32 spots on every game, there'll be a spot. Anyway, that was the beginning of the series. It ran for 26 years. We did over 1,000 commercials. And we had all of the great stars, but we had to balance them out between offensive and defensive players. Every team, when you ask them which player, get a quarterback. Everybody likes the quarterback. But what about the kicker who missed last week? Or the lineman who's 390 pounds, you know, who's down in the mud down there and the thing? Well, we did them all. And I went for what I think was valuable is not just the guy, but where did he come from? Who was he? What was he about? And one of all the letters of accolades I got, all the awards that the series has won, like the famous one is the picture that's out now of the PR guy in San Diego, whose wife said, oh, I forget all the games, but I never forget those spots with the children and all. What really worked great was the idea that this fellow in Detroit, he was like 6'9" or something, huge man. And they told him, you're going to go make your TV spot. And he said, can I have my family? I said, oh, yes, you will bring your family. And we went to this hospital, and they had crack babies. It takes $100,000 30 days to take care of a crack baby. And some of the mothers are heroin addicts. They have a child, they come in 9 months later, have another child, and leave them. They get up and walk out of the hospital, and society's like. And they said, we make the spot about the crack babies. So I said, well, could we see a crack baby? Yeah. They put the crack baby on one of these rolling tables and that. I sat him down like he was sitting me here. And he had this huge hand, right? And the little baby is there like this, just a little infant. And it's going through contractions. And what do I do? I said, you just look at the baby and then look back at the camera and read what it says. The teleprompter's right through the just. And he looked over and he put his hand up by the baby and his pinky, like this. The little baby's hand reached up and curled around the edge of his pinky. And he sat there and he said, he saw that and he said, I don't know if you care about these kids as much as I do, but I care about them an awful lot. And I hope you do too. Wow. It was so powerful.
The cries of these newborn members of the human race are not like other children. They don't cry for food or water or nurturing. They cry for crack. They are among the thousands born into this world addicted to drugs or alcohol. I'm Lomas Brown of the Detroit Lions, and I want to tell you all about the important programs that the United Way and the NFL are committed to. Here in Michigan, in Oakland County alone, $1 million is being raised to fund programs to deal with substance abuses. Can't any of us turn our backs on the cries of these innocent victims? I don't think we will. I know I can't. When we give to the United Way, we're reaching out a hand to the smallest victims of drugs and the violence and the suffering they breed. It doesn't do any good to cry for them, but it will help if you give, if you care. The United Way, it brings out the best in all of us.
This message furnished by the National Football League.
For 25 years, you've seen the NFL United Way Great Moments Series. Players, coaches, owners, fans, joining together as volunteers and givers to make our communities safer, healthier, and better for all of us. What started from an idea has grown to become the largest, longest-running public service campaign in television history, reaching more than 113 million viewers each weekend throughout the NFL season. With the airtime contributed to the United Way by the NFL, now the most highly awarded public service series consisting of more than 700 commercials featuring NFL players, coaches, owners, and professionals, all serving as United Way volunteers. This series has made the NFL the envy of all major league sports. Individual United Ways rank the series among the highest programs that complement their fundraising and communications efforts in their local communities. United Way fundraising receipts have risen from $800 million in 1974, when the series started, to over $3 billion. Commissioner Paul Tagliabue took over the leadership of the NFL in 1989. He knew the value of the series to the NFL and the personal commitment that Pete had made to helping people through the United Way, and the value he placed on the character of the men who played the game.
Before I introduce a few of the NFL representatives who are here tonight who have made this partnership such a success, I must first salute the individual, he's out here with us tonight, who has produced each of the 700 plus spots over the past 19 years. He interrupted his current tour of NFL cities to be with us here tonight. He's a very, very special friend of mine, a special friend of all of us in the National Football League, and a special servant of all of us in the United Way movement. He's a creative genius. He works everyone very, very hard. I'm sure Steve Wallace knows that, as all of us who've appeared in United Way spots can attest. I want him to stand up and take a bow. Mario Pellegrini.
Mario went on with his career, not only in television, but in writing, producing and directing a series of 27 motion pictures that conveyed the drama and real life and loves that gave viewers hope in their own lives. These films were shown across the nation and brought great success. Major stars volunteered to be in his films. Stars like Edward G. Robinson, Robert Redford, Martin Balsam, Eddie Albert, and Gregory Peck.
Americans have always been dreamers. Sometimes their visions and ideas have changed the face of our nation. One idea started 100 years ago, mile high in the Rocky Mountains. Out of the boom and bust of the gold rush, something happened, something uniquely American. An idea was born. In Denver in 1887, there were people who needed help. And as always in our country, there were those who wanted to help. 4 men of different faiths were meeting. Monsignor William O'Ryan, a Catholic, Father Martin Hart, an Episcopalian, the Reverend Myron Reed, a Congregationalist, and Rabbi William Friedman.
Housing in a few short years. There's not enough housing, there's no sanitation, and there are children working in the mines. Yes. And still they come with hopes of getting rich.
And they soon realize that when something like that fire strikes, it destroys everything. Not only lives are lost, but when people have no hopes, no dreams, well, that's why we're here. We all saw what happened the other night. I heard the bell ringing. I went to the call down by the river.
Volunteers were already bringing water, but it was useless against that wind. Those poor souls didn't have a chance. And out of that inferno, came a family, a mother and her 3 young ones. Everyone was doing what they could, but when this woman looked at me...
You know about my husband? He got us out that he went back to the others. We don't know where he is.
My daddy coming back.
Is there any place for us?
Many of these actors were Academy Award winners. Stars like Warren Beatty, James Whitmore, Tony Curtis, Elizabeth Taylor, and Mickey Rooney.
No wonder with the status of things the way they are down there, inflation, the dollar slipping. It's no wonder requests for miracles are more than we can handle.
These new arrivals just aren't ready. It's a wonder any of them will even get through the pearly gate.
Well, what is it?
It's here, sir. A guy named Joe Nolan. He works at a big plant, has 3 kids, and he's just barely getting by.
Teresa, don't we have an angel in our student training course that hasn't earned his wings yet?
Well, there is one name. Clarence Potter.
Clarence Potter, report to Heaven Central.
Yes, sir, right away. Oh, boy, maybe this is my chance to earn my wings. Maybe it's my miracle assignment. Coming, sir. Sir, here I am. Yes. I'm here, sir.
So you're Clarence Potter?
Yes, sir. I'm Clarence Potter.
Clarence,
Not everybody gets a third chance. Now, I don't have to tell you what'll happen if you botch this miracle, and we don't have much time.
Well, I've done my best, even though I'll try, sir, I'll try.
Hi, Joe. Who are you? I'm Clarence Potter, and I'm an angel.
You what?
I'm an angel.
An angel?
An angel.
What are you doing here?
Well, you said you needed a miracle. That's why I'm here.
Hey, come on, angels have wings.
Yeah, I know, but angels have to earn their wings, too, and I've got a lot of earning to do. What with my harp lessons and trying to perform a miracle for you?
A miracle? What is this, some kind of a joke or something? You know, you really shouldn't go around dressed like that.
This is no joke, Joe. How else would I know about your wife's illness, and your children, your job problems? Remember yesterday at the hospital?
Oh, yeah. You don't look like an angel. You look more like that biscuit doughboy.
Well, I'm not that biscuit doughboy. I am an angel. I just have to work out a way to performing a miracle for you, that's all. Now, Joe, I want you to listen to me. I showed you a lot of people. There are thousands more like them that are... Well, they all get together and make millions of little miracles happen every day. Coming back reminded me of that. Well, I'll have to be going.
Clarence, wait.
No, I can't do it for you, Joe. You're going to have to do it for yourself. Just believe.
Clarence, don't go. I don't know what to do.
Sure you do. Just believe. Believe in the good in people. Believe in the good in people. And listen for the bell, because when you hear that bell, I'll have gotten my wings. Just believe, Joe. And listen for the bell.
Clarence? Clarence?
He worked with many stars like Joanne Woodward, Chuck Connors, James Caan, Eli Wallach, and John Forsythe.
Our lead story tonight covers the continued turmoil in the Middle East. In Washington, the president called for new peace initiatives. The new tax bill is meeting with partisan opposition in both the House and the Senate.
Ready?
The president has indicated he would not veto the bill. It's a provision moving to set new standards for consumer use. Well, thank you for Chris Kelly and Al Thomas, and thank you for the good weather. This is Dan Reynolds for your Action News team, hoping your news is good news.
Okay, we're on the network line. Thank you, people.
Nice show, Miss Kelly. You too, Al.
Excellent show tonight, Dan.
Thank you. Couldn't do it without the producer, you know.
I thank you.
Dan, Mr. Butler would like to see you in his office. Something important has come up.
Oh, that means more work.
No doubt.
Dan?
Yeah?
Got a special bulletin. A little girl has been lost.
So what's new? Kids and animals are always getting lost.
This little girl, Nancy Wiskowski, is special. She's only 5 years old and she's deaf. She wandered out of her yard. Now it's been hours and they still can't find her. She's in danger every minute.
Nancy Wiskowski. That's the little girl at the speech center. I talked to her mother. Tony, it's on our film. See if you can get it on the monitor.
Okay.
Now you call Mrs. Wiskowski and ask her to come down here for an on-the-air appeal. I'll go on the air every 30 minutes with bulletins. See if you can do that with her.
You got it.
Hey, Dan, here's the little girl. We can make a transfer and put it on the air.
Poor little kid. She's so helpless.
This is
is a community-wide search. The child won't respond to calls she can't hear, and she's in constant danger. She wandered off earlier in the day, and it's critical that she be found before dark. Now, if you have any information or can help in the search, call us here at Action News Center. Thank you. If you have any information or can help in the search, call us here at Action News Center. Thank you.
Dan.
Dan, they found her.
Why, Nancy. Oh, Nancy, I'm so glad we found you. Hello, Mrs. Laskowski. We've been looking all over for you. Do you know that?
Stars like Ben Vereen, David Janssen, and Greg Morris, Orson Welles, and Charles Bronson.
He burst across the screen like a prairie fire, an American hero, fighting against the odds. Not always winning, but always tough. And committed to what he believed in. In more than 60 films, Charles Bronson has become an international star. He's a hero to millions in countries around the world. And what he stands for in the hearts and minds of Americans is the stuff that heroes are made of. Charles Bronson is more than a tough guy. He has a unique quality that people identify with, that deeper sense of honesty that grows from a first-hand knowledge of the hard side of life. His roots are in a coal mining town in the mountains of Pennsylvania, where he was one of 15 brothers and sisters, a son of a coal miner, raised during the worst depression in the nation's history. He knew hunger and poverty, desperation firsthand. In those days, there was no subsidized housing, only a coal miner's shack. No food stamps or welfare, no agencies to reach out to help the family when there was sickness or cold or hunger. The hard times of those early years are still seen in Charles Bronson today. Perhaps that's what burns deep in the eyes of this hero with a sensitive soul. He's everyone's idea of a hero, a tough guy. But what does he really think about being tough? And who does he feel are the real heroes in life?
I'm Charles Bronson. For me, the real heroes aren't those we find on the screen. The real heroes in life are everyday people. And some of the toughest challenges fate can dish out are met and conquered by people who have real courage and compassion. Sometimes it's because they know someone's counting on them, and sometimes their strength comes in knowing that somebody cares about them and loves them. That's what gives them the strength to tough it out. The real heroes in life aren't always famous. They come in all sizes, men and women who, without ever being noticed, win some of the biggest battles that the human heart has to face.
Stars like Earl Holliman, Dean Jones, Cliff Robertson. He worked with many stars, and his favorite was Jack Lemmon.
Someone there?
Yeah, it's me, Ma, George.
Oh, George, I'm so glad you came.
Listen, Ma, what's with the sending me a note? Why is your phone out of order? Why all the unpaid bills?
Well, Your father never wants me to talk to you about our problems. But you know how he is with you. You know how proud he is. Your father and I always felt that you had your own lives to live, that you had your own problems. But I'm worried. It's not just the bills. It's your father. He's very sick.
I'll be okay.
You seen Dr. Nolan?
He's my doctor, isn't he?
Yeah, but have you seen him?
He gave me that medicine to take. A lot of damn good it's doing.
That medicine's over a month old.
George, listen. I've been sick before. I'll be all right. I don't need you to come over here and tell me what to do. I've been taking care of myself for 72 years, and you're not going to start taking...
Look, you've let this go too long already. I'm calling Dr. Nolan and making arrangements.
I don't want you making arrangements for me. I'll make my own arrangements. Think I'm senile or something? And you're not going to put me in any hospital either.
This is different. You can't just lie there, Dad. I've got to get you to a hospital to find out what's wrong with you, and I'm going to call the doctor.
I've gotten over these things before. Not as if I'm helpless.
Emergency room. Dr. Nolan, emergency room.
Nurse, this is George Bailey. I told him he could see his dad for a few minutes.
Fine. It'll just be a minute. I'm giving him some medication.
Oh.
Dr. Grant, ring 541.
Dr. Grant, ring 541. I used to live over there. It's before this hospital was even built. So over there by the river. Because there was a park nearby. It was the greatest place in the world. My father used to bring me there when I was a kid. Yeah, you hear people playing that crazy game. You could smell the beer and the hot dogs. And, well, 4th of July. See, the whole sky was just filled with fireworks. My dad used to bring me through the crowds on his shoulders. You know, I felt like I was on top of the world. He was a big man then. In this time, my dad. Everybody knew him. Old dad, you know, he always had a kind word for everybody. Helping hand. Anybody needed it. You know, it was that kind of town. It's not there anymore, though, that part. Oh, God, things have changed, haven't they? I don't know what it is. Today's, well, nobody's got any time. We're just in such a hurry. And afraid. Don't trust anything. And everybody's going somewhere. Nobody knows why. And nobody cares anymore. My father's in there. He gave his whole life to this town. What does it mean? He's just another old man. His whole life just forgotten.
In my work, I see a lot of people like your dad. He's proud. He's frightened. He's lonely. But I know out there, there are still a lot of people who care.
Mr. Bailey?
Huh?
You can go in now.
Oh.
George. I'll leave you alone with him. But remember, he needs his rest.
How you doing, old timer?
Doing okay, George.
Yeah. The doc says there's nothing to worry about. By the end of the week, you'll be pinching nurses.
Got one picked out already.
Dad, there's a lot of things that we've never said to each other. And I know that you're going to be okay. You're going to make it. But I just wanted to tell you that...
Look. Listen, George, you don't have to say anything. I understand. I know it was never your fault. Just me and my ornery ways. I guess I never took the time.
We never took the time.
Is Mom all right? Tell her not to worry now.
You get your rest. Mom will be fine. I love you.
And there were singers and talented performers like Barry Manilow, the Bee Gees, and Gloria Estefan.
Each and every moment searching what to believe. Coming out of the dark, I finally see the light now, and it's shining on me. Coming out of the dark, I know the love that saved me.
And stars like Loretta Lynn, Johnny Cash, and Tony Bennett.
When there are clouds in the sky, you get by. If you smile through your fears and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness. Hide every trace of sadness. Although a tear may be ever so near, that's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile. If you just smile. That's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile. If you just smile.
Mr. Frank Sinatra.
What is America to me? A name, a map, a flag I see. A certain word, democracy. What is America to me? The house I live in, a plot of earth, a street, the grocer and the butcher, and the people that I meet, the children in the playground, the faces that I see, all races and religions, that's America to me. The place I work in, the worker by my side, the little town or city where my people lived and died. The howdy and the handshake, the air of feeling free, and the right to speak my mind now, that's America to me. The things I see about me, the big things and the small, the little corner newsstand, and the house a mile tall, the wedding and the churchyard, the laughter and the tears, and the dream that's been a-growing for about 200 years. The town I live in, the street, the house, the room, the pavement of the city, or a garden all in bloom, the church, the school, the clubhouse, the million lights I see, but especially the people.
For me, having a program that you struggle over is writing it, and 2 years later, it's finally on the screen, and you sit in the darkened theater in the back of the room, and at a certain point, you hear the audiences, oh, they laugh at the right places, and they cry where it's necessary. And that's a confirmation that when you sat in that room 2 years ago with a pencil and paper and said, and the girl will walk in and she'll say this, and this will and he'll react this way and everything, the storyboards that we create and everything. This is the confirmation of a creative fulfillment.